welcome. So we try to handle the loudness of these speakers. Thank you very much for coming to this place. I think that the main reason to come to this session is to sit in this wonderful building. We both welcome you very much to the panel, Who Owns the City? Insights of a Crowdsource-Based Investigation. Just would like to introduce ourselves very shortly.
Mm-hmm. You start?
Yes. Hello. So my name is Annelise Bouillet, and I'm leading the tech and data team at Corrective. So Corrective is a center for a non-profit investigation, but you will explain later. And our main job in our team, so we are a developer, data journalist, and a graphic designer that works together closely with the reporters to build tools and to install process and methodology how to help them with working with data, analyze the data, and visualize the data.
Yeah, and my name is Justus von Daniels. I'm head of Corrective Local. So maybe a couple of sentences, where we work for. So Corrective is a Germany-based, or Germany's first actually non-profit newsroom. So we are a little bit different from many other medias in our country, but there are, as you might know, many other attempts to set up non-profit journalism organizations all over Europe and the world. Corrective is one of it. So what we do is we are a team of, let's say, about 35 people, mainly focusing on investigative journalism. We are building or kind of building up a section which is called Corrective Local, where we create a network for investigative local journalism. So this is a network for local journalists to explore issues together. And we also, as Annelise was mentioning, we have a very strong tech team, which is also developing new methodologies to work in the journalistic world. And one of this methodology is we call it the crowd newsroom. And this is something we want to explain a little bit about it and show you how we try to manage to work with thousands of people together. So how we get like thousands of people as a source, how we structure information, what we do with it, and actually why we collect it. Giving you a brief overview where we start and where we end in a couple of minutes, maybe 30 or 40 minutes. We have one example of an ongoing investigation, Who Owns the City, which we try to use an example to show you how we work, and this is also like a way to show you why a crowdsourcing in the journalistic field makes sense when you use it. So, which questions do you want to answer, and how you have to work with it? We will present you how we developed the crowd newsroom. So, we take you a little bit on the journey: what happened, what worked, what didn't work, where we are at the moment. And also like how we, if you're working with a lot of people outside, with many citizens, you have to get the news out that there is a kind of a newsroom, which is a crowd newsroom. So we will talk a little bit about the campaign, what we got as a result, and how the future might look. And especially in that sense, how you might also like make use of the crowd newsroom, because essentially the crowd newsroom is something we develop not only for us, but for everyone to use. So I think more about 2 years ago, we were observing or kind of exploring a new topic we want to work a little bit more intensely about from an investigative perspective. And that was the housing market in Germany. So at that time, there was the upcoming debate that there's a huge, fast coming pressure on the housing market, on the tenants, because the prices in Germany, like in many European cities and countries, rose or skyrocketed in the last years. So it was harder and harder for tenants actually to survive in their apartments. And so the housing question became kind of an existential question in Germany for many, many people in many, many cities. At the same time, we read a lot about money laundering, you know, which were explored by a lot of media at that time. A lot of these laundered money, a lot of dirty money, is laundered in the real estate market, and a huge chunk of it is in Germany. This is kind of it's kind of an open secret. Everybody knows about it, but nobody knows exactly anything about it. So it's hard to find any good studies. It's hard to find any good police or court people, policemen who tell you about it, because there's not much knowledge about the housing market. Because one reason is Germany, as other countries as well, there's a huge intransparency. So the book, the land registry in Germany, is one of the most closed books in Germany. So it's very hard to get to information. So it's very hard actually to get to know who's actually active in this field, who's acting as a player, who are the investors, who are the owners of these houses, you know, what's their policy, what's their structure, their idea. So it's really hard to investigate it. But we thought it's worth to do it. So we have to find a new way how to get to this information, who actually owns a house in Germany. So that's why we came up with the idea that tenants generally know about the owner of their house. So they know a tiny little piece of information, and if we kind of collect as many information as possible, kind of can put the puzzle together and learn something more. So we thought about let's do it with the crowd together, and let's do it in a structured way, not only like asking them, you know, tell us the owner, and then we say, okay, we believe you, but we wanted also like to have a proof system. We wanted to have a system where citizens actually could kind of upload or give us information in a proved way, so we can really work with it within our journalistic realm. So as you can see, we kind of thought that we would actually demand a lot from people. So people would give us kind of private individual information. They would give us information about information about ownership. So our question was, will they ever jump over the bar to send us information plus proof, because people are not used to do it. As a journalist, when you start an investigation, you make a kind of a wish list. So what would be the ideal world to get all this information together, to tell a good story about some truth, about the, you know, about ownership, about housing market issues? So we kind of thought about a few pillars we would like to assemble, to get together. So we wanted to collect information and stories in a structured way. Information from maybe 100 or thousands of people. So you need to organize this kind of information, which is actually quite a huge deal. But we also wanted to create a platform which could work as a honeypot. You know, like the large news corporations, they usually have like anonymous letterboxes where you can send in some material which they can work with. So people know that. So, you know, for them, it's a kind of, for the larger news organizations, they know how to get a honeypot. So we said, okay, we also want to create a situation where people can give us more information if they have more knowledge. So if they're a politician, they know exactly what's going on, they should come to us. We also wanted, because it's a crowd-based investigation, we also wanted to work with the community. We just didn't want only to use a community or use like people to participate, but we also wanted to get people activated in the sense of you should also participate in the debate, you know, how the housing market in your city actually should look like. How you can help us, maybe how you can provide us with new ideas to think about new topics. So it was also like about activation and offering a realm of a space for debate, and maybe also like finding solutions. So as I mentioned, this was kind of our wish list. So we weren't really sure, you know, if we can actually execute any of this and how the tech team would react to this. So first of all, we said, okay, let's make some like more concrete list of how, first of all, the data collection should look like. Because if you're doing a crowdsourced project, you can actually ask all kinds of questions. But if you have like a survey or a kind of an interview you're leading with the citizens, and if you ask too many questions, they might drop out because they are bored or they don't know why should I actually deliver this information. So we thought about how to structure this kind of interview which we would like to lead with the citizens in the virtual world. You know, like what kind of questions would I like to ask to the people? So we thought about the questions. We thought about if you start a crowd-based project, you have to think about which kind of group you want to get. You know, you can't speak to a whole country because then it's kind of a very diverse kind of information you might get. So you think, or if you're doing this kind of investigation, you should think about maybe you can narrow the group a little bit. That's why actually we started to say, you know, we don't ask who owns the world, but let's say who owns a specific city. So we actually target a specific group, meaning the inhabitants of a city. Then you think about the amount and the quality of information in terms of, there was a debate we had a long time, what are the questions which are most interesting for the tenants? So the tenants, normally, they want to know about their rent. So my rent is rising, or my tenant, he's a bad tenant. So this is always a nice way to enter, you know, the contact to the citizens, because it's easy, because they immediately react. If you ask them about the ownership, they might not really know why they should give this information, what's for. So we had debates about, you know, how to frame the initial question. The initial question where you can drag the people into the interview. So we decided actually not to focus so much on the rent in the first place, but really on the question we would like to answer and try to convince the people to participate in our kind of research. So the question we came up with in the end, which you might easily guess, was the first question, what is the name of the owner of your flat? That was the key information we wanted to get. And how this crowd newsroom actually came to life and if this wish list could be fulfilled, Annelies will explore.
Yes, so to answer this question, then we had several options, but we wanted to have a platform where everything is at one place. So Corrective already had two or three experience of crowdsource-based investigation, but it was not made where everything is in one place. So data were a bit all over the place, and for the third one, we decided, okay, let's bring together the community, so what we call the community, it's the citizen, but as well the reporters and the media partners. And through the platform, the community could share their data, and then all of it, the reporter and the media partner would create stories and give it back to the community. So this is the idea of the Crown Newsroom. And then the first thing that came into our mind and what you might think as well is why such a platform is not overkill, why not just using a Google form, for instance, because if you have one question, what's the name of the owner of your flat, why putting so much effort in this? And we have several reasons for this. The first one is when you are doing crowdsourcing, each contributor is a source for a journalist. So it's a bit different because you have thousands of sources, but you should treat them with the exact same level of confidentiality and respect the anonymity of all the contributors. So for us, for instance, using a Google form, for instance, was not an option. We wanted to ensure people that their data, their private data, will be safe on our server and secure. So the data privacy and protection was the main point. The second point is we realized quickly that we needed special feature because we didn't want only to collect the data, but then what are you doing once you collect data? You have like thousands of answers, and if you start just using email, it can get quickly complicated. So we defined together the feature that we wanted. So this is what looks like the what we call the backend. So once the people contribute, it is what it looks like. So I anonymize, as I just said before, the main information. And the ID was, because if you use, for instance, a simple form, you can only visualize the data or download the data as a CSV. But we wanted a platform to collaborate. So to share the work with the journalists, so you can decide the ownership. So for instance, say which person in the team is responsible for treating this information. And of course, the first thing that you do when you receive thousands of data is you start to filter, since the beginning, the trash answer, because you don't have, we didn't have that much, but still we have spam, tests, or things that can pollute your work. And something that we underestimate as well at the beginning, but we quickly fix this, it's the fact-checking of the data. So we realize that, here. So this is what an answer looks like. It's easier to fact-check the data the moment you are filtering it for trash. So here, the journalist will go through every answer, verify, download the proof, or visualize it, correct the mistake. We have edit field as well because some people, they do some maybe like typo or misspelling something. And what we underestimate at the beginning was the follow-up. So it's not just we receive an answer and now, okay, it's verified, it's done. Sometimes, and not most of the time, but it's happened often that, for instance, the document that people uploaded as a proof is blurry or is not the right document, and you have to continue the conversation and sending emails. So we can see here, for instance, the journalist write comment as well and ask more information. So I send an email to ask more information to this person on this date. And we, on this platform, we can follow up as well. And the third point why we didn't want to use only a simple form is we wanted to test and to be able to refine the question, so kind of A-B testing. For instance, we wanted to start with some text and maybe 2 weeks later change a bit, the rephrase it to see what can work better, maybe add some question in between, remove some question. And this is not visible in our cron newsroom, but it's all the coding and the backend. We use versioning. So each form has a version, and for the reporter, it's if the reporter, for instance, change or remove one question, the data that the people answered before this question are not lost. So we are keeping track of every version at one place. And it's something that, for instance, a Google form could not have done. And yes, this was the three important points, but actually the main point that we realized quickly as well, it's not a simple question, actually. So we can think, so our research question is, what's the name of the owner of your flat? But for instance, if I ask you, how many of you in the room know the name of the owner of your flat? Okay, and among you, for instance, how many of you can be sure that the person you think is the owner of your flat is the real owner and not the landlord or the manager? Yes. And then the third filter, how many of you among the ones that raise your hand can have a proof, a written document to prove the owner of your flat? Now, as you see, now we end up with two persons. And this was the main challenge. So we started to ask the people. So this is what it looks like, because we are talking about what the form looks like, but actually it doesn't look very special. It's just a succession of questions and button to press for the user. So we start to ask, okay, do you know this? Exactly the kind of the same thing that I made with you. Do you know who is the owner of your flat? And depending on their answer, it's not linear. And actually in the back end, it looks like this. So yes, we have several options. So first we have, for instance, okay, if you don't know who is the owner of your flat, we can help you investigate. Then we give them some hints. For instance, did you receive in the last 2 years an official letter to raise the rent, for instance? Because in Germany, at least, by law, when you receive such a letter, the name of the owner of your flat has to be written in there. And we have kind of succession of questions to, it's not a form, it's actually like a real interview like you would have done with a source. And at the end, if really the person has no clue or no way to know, then we suggest them that they can do, in German it's called a Grundprogramm request, so it's a request to the
land registry.
So to the land registry. So in Germany, when you are the tenant of a flat, you are allowed, it's not public information because you have to be the tenant to ask this, but then you can have this information. So we gave them all the information, and they could have gave us as well a procuration for us to do this request in their name. And of course, we were sharing the result with them at the end. So it's not that simple at the end. Yes, and then it's about about campaigning.
Yeah, it does. It's not that simple, but in the end, for a journalist who would in the future actually set up a whole crowd newsroom, it is actually simple. Everything outside or from the outside looks simple. So for, as we showed you the interview, so the kind of questions we ask, it looks very simple for the user. So the user, if he actually knows the owner of his apartment, he's through in 2 to 3 minutes. So he can actually easily go through the process. Many of them did exactly this. And even for journalists to work with the structured data, So the two forms which Annelies showed, the kind of front end, are also like easy kind of tables to use. So it's easy actually to work as a journalist with the structured information you get. But coming back to the question, so once you define a question you want to raise with a crowd, you can, in the next 20 minutes, you can think, in any question you might think where the crowd might be useful for an investigation you would like to do. So once you found these questions, once you set up this interview, you have to think about, how to reach people to fill in the interview. And at Correctiv, we are a fairly small organization. So we are, an online-based newsroom. So I would guess that even in Germany, many people wouldn't have heard about us. So that's why we set up a structure to say, okay, we want to cooperate with partners, with a media partner in a certain city, also with initiatives maybe, not working together with initiatives, but actually approaching initiatives and saying, if you like to push this project, which is a journalistic project, please spread it as much as possible, because we need people. We started our first project in April last year in Hamburg, which is a fairly big city, so the second largest city in Germany. It has a very high-priced housing market. There are rumors about investors. There are many, many problems with tenants. So it was a good location actually to start with. So we took the biggest newspaper, the biggest local newspaper of Hamburg, and said, okay, let's team up together. So you can actually get stories from our newsroom. You collect it together with us, and we kind of reach an audience. So that was actually the first thing we did, which was actually a good example, which we follow up in our current projects, which we come later to. As I mentioned, we also try to team up or kind of try to attract initiatives. For example, in Germany, you have like in any country, you have like tenants initiatives, tenants associations. So there was something we didn't know in Hamburg because we are based in Berlin, which was a little bit dangerous for us because we ran into a kind of a situation of strong fights between initiatives in Hamburg. So we didn't know that between tenants initiatives there's a huge competition going on at the same time. So actually we approached the biggest association. They said, yes, we'd like to spread the news. We would like to ask our members to participate in the crowd newsroom, which was very good. Then we asked the second largest association, and they said, ah, you're working with the largest association, we can't work with you. Because they are our competitors. And we said, you know, I think your competitors should be the investors or should be the owners, not the other tenants. So it was actually a hard fight. And in the beginning, it was the situation that they were actually fighting against us. So they were actively promoting not to support this project. Which was very weird for us, but over the time we understood there was a lot of personal fight between these people, so we couldn't solve this immediately. But this was the this is actually a kind of way that you look for a large partner. If you are a large newspaper, of course you can do it on your own. That's much much easier. But we also thought about other ideas to lead this debate. What I said in the beginning, we wanted also to activate people. We wanted to get to open up a debate because we said, you know, we wanted to come from a different, from a slightly new perspective talking about the housing market. So actually we organized public debates with politicians, initiatives, to talk exactly about one issue. What's the role of the owner? Not about what's the problems for the tenants, but what's the role of the owner? Who is actually, you know, what's their, what are the biggest problems? We asked the city, what do they know? And that was also very interesting because there was a debate coming up. The city actually answered, we know who Hamburg owns. We know the biggest investors. So the guy who was saying this was sitting on a podium with us. So we asked him the second question, please tell us the five biggest ones. He said, yeah, that's difficult to say. So he didn't know, and he wasn't really sure. And then we asked officially, and officially the city couldn't answer this question. So that was actually a very good start to say maybe it's useful to do it. But we also tried to, there were attempts to play with this kind of project. So we kind of got people from an art school involved. They thought about, you know, how can we actually translate who owns Hamburg into art? How can we translate the crowd newsroom, this initiative, into art? So there were kind of many, many ideas coming up, playful things like, so this is the picture on the right side, the down one. So in the beginning when we started actually, we had a local office there. We set up a local office for 2 months where we kind of were approachable and wanted to get into conversation. So in the window of this local office, we put a piece of chalk for every contributor, and the different colors of these chalks meant, you know, this is a contributor, so it means the neighborhood in Hamburg where this contributor comes from. So we kind of started to saying, you know, which neighborhood is leading, you know, in this search. So which neighborhood is very active, which is not active. So we kind of, so the, so So the students from the art school, they kind of made this chalk chart, kind of. So we kind of try to involve or lead this debate in various ways. One question which came up in the beginning, and many people ask before we launched the project, was the question, what does the person get from us? We actually get a lot from them, but what do they get, actually, except some late information at a later stage? So we thought about what could be an immediate reward for participation. I think for crowd sourcing, this is a very vital and interesting question. Yeah, we would like to answer this with a nice present or with a nice information we could have given to the people in Hamburg which participated, but we couldn't really find a very good one. So the only one was that we found a database from the city. The database very much localizes where in the city are private and public owned houses. So in a very general way, one, two. So we kind of scraped these informations, and immediately after the interview, the participant got a thank you page saying thank you that you please follow us, that you see the results of our investigations later on. But here's also like a small chart, 100 meters around your apartment, so and so many houses are privately and publicly owned. So it was a very general information, but it was kind of a, we tried to show our will that we wanted to give them something back. Over time, we did this campaign over 8 weeks in Hamburg, and we were, during that time, we were actually quite interested in what are the responses of the people. So how do they, not only in terms of figures, so how many people really participate, how many valid informations and documents do we get, but also like in which ways do they respond? Are they skeptical? Do they complain? Are they happy? So we kind of collected a lot of these informations actually to learn from this for future projects and maybe also for future crowd newsrooms to do it better. For example, one thing we couldn't really track is how many people started to fill in this form and didn't finish it because they think after a while, oh, come on, it's too complicated, or I don't have my contract here because I'm at work or I'm in the underground, and dropped out. So maybe, you know, the figures of people who would like to participate was much higher than the actual number of people who participated. So this would be actually something to, or was actually something we think we should work on. We found out that part of the interview, as you normally do in every survey, you leave an open field. You say, tell us your story, tell us your concern. We called it the tenant's story. So we kind of included it in the interview, and we were very, very much surprised how many people actually wrote their stories or wrote something about their relationship about their owner or their knowledge about their owner or the problems or maybe a public a political statement. So there were like hundreds of people offering first-hand stories. And as a journalist, you know, this is something you couldn't wish for more. Yeah, you have a protagonist, you know, for free, you know, like without looking for him or her. So there's this person saying, you know, that's our issue in our house. And if we see, you know, it really fits into our investigation because it shows on an individual basis a structural problem we find out about, we kind of contact this person and say, can we really work with you that you might appear in the story? So that was actually, or that is actually a very, very important and vital part from our perspective. A huge issue which came up and which comes up in every debate is the issue of data privacy. People say, you know, like, are my data safe, me as a tenant, because I give a lot of information, as Annelies showed, you know, like emails, address, maybe part of the contract. So there's a lot of information which we store in our server. There was also some kind of insecurity. You know, am I really allowed to give you the name of the owner of my apartment? So I think we were able to answer all these questions. We could actually, I mean, that was a very thorough process to make sure that we kind of comply with all new data privacy laws, and could actually even tell the owners, for example, an owner who has just one apartment or one house, is a small private owner, you know, maybe he has fear that he appears in the public, in the newspaper for some reason, because Correctiv might publish a list of all owners they got. So we actually tried to explain all the many, many times that this is not our interest and this is not something we are allowed to do. So if you collect information, you always have to make sure that you kind of give the information back, you know, what you do with this information. So that we do use the information for our internal investigations or with our internal research, that we don't just publish any lists. So it's a kind of, their part was to deliver us something and we have to make something out of it. So it was, so that was actually quite an issue to talk about. The outcomes of the real project of the Wem gehört Hamburg project, you can actually have a, if you read German, you can have a look at the webpage. I won't go into detail because we won't tell too much about this, or we can discuss it if you really have questions, but maybe two or three important points. One question we had in the beginning, the hidden investor. Who are, you know, like big investors nobody knows about, and maybe they have a reason that they want to try, that they would like to stay anonymous. So we actually were able to find out about some investors which had like different companies with different names in the same city, and we got a lot of complaints from tenants from different apartments and different houses by the same company. So we could actually assemble some good stories about, you know, why is this investor, you know, not really open, and how come that there's so many complaints about this investor? Who is actually the real owner of this investor? So we could actually make stories about this. But we, an important point from our point of view was also like track down the policy of the city itself. So Hamburg has a very huge chunk of city-run apartments, like more than 100,000. And they have a very good, officially, it has these companies, this company has a very good reputation because it's city-owned. Rents are low, you know, apartments are clean, everything is fine. And we actually found out through a lot of hints, yeah, we collected, we kind of structured the informations, many complaints about very, very high rent rises of these city-owned apartments. So we could make a story out of this. We actually asked the city, you know, could we actually publish, you know, where the apartments are? And they were very, very, they tried to stay arcane, so they didn't really want to tell where their apartments are. So we were kind of wondering why does a local authority doesn't disclose, you know, their apartments. So we found out more about that. And then we could also like talk about, you know, tax haven business structures. We also found out about in Hamburg, but much more. We are doing a similar project in Berlin, where we find new stories. So this was the simple answer we could give to the people in Hamburg. We kind of mapped what we got. The map is a very superficial map. You can't really see the real data, so you can't really zoom in because that was also like part of the privacy debate. But you could see what we get, where certain structures, certain types of investors are in the city, are located. So from the journalistic perspective, were we happy with it? So with these outcomes, what was the, how could we actually publish our stories? I think in the end, we can say that together with our local partner, with a media partner in Hamburg, we were kind of successful in the way that we published more than 30 stories with them together. We had a large landing page. They actually were able to print a 6-page print inlay of their newspapers about the whole project. Also to show how much they invested in kind of following these like long-term project. And if you like, you know, the political impact in Hamburg is a political discourse in the city council, which is happening about the right, about how the city itself runs its own apartments, houses, which was something which didn't happen before. So Hamburg was a good test case for us. So we thought, why shouldn't we expand this? I mean, that was also like an initial plan to go to other cities and to offer it to other media partners. Or maybe other media partners are mostly coming to us and asking if they could actually do the same. So we learned a lot from Hamburg, and so far we're doing this crowd newsroom project with 6 media partners at the moment, and we will do it with many more. Ideally we would like to expand it to every kind of city or every kind of country which where these issues of housing market issues are coming up. So it's not that we always have to do it ourselves, so we as journalists, but we actually, and this is what Annelies will tell you in a minute, we provide or can provide the infrastructure to do this kind of crowd newsroom investigation. So we can actually give everyone else who wants to do it in every country the tools for it. But maybe Annelies is...
Yes, but first, so to sum up, you wanted to talk and when is it important and when it's needed to crowdsource information? So for us, it's 3 points, main points. First, to investigate using the power of the crowd. So when you have maybe not millions, but thousands of documents to analyze, it's very useful to ask some external help. And where, for instance, example, when a lot of repetitive tasks are needed. And as you used to say before, for our investigation, for instance, each tenant has a piece of information, and it's useful to have the big picture and to reconstruct the puzzle. A second point where crowdsourcing, we find it very important, is to can work as a counter power. We can create a database on topics that authority or official don't cover because they have no interest in it. I'm thinking, for instance, I don't know if you know the project The Counted by The Guardian. So it's a project I crowdsource the number of people killed by the police in the US. And crowdsourcing in this kind of situation is very important because, again, the police, they have no interest of keeping track and creating a database on this issue. And the last point, as I used to say, is to build a network around a topic. Journalists are becoming experts on a topic, but as well with the help of contributors and people that we reached through crowdsourcing. So what about the future for our crowd newsroom? We would really love to open it. So it's already open in the sense that the code is open source. Anyone can download it, reusing it. But in the future, we really want to open it to every journalist, every newsroom. And where the goal is like any journalist could set up easily their own investigation. So this would mean to be to have a generic platform. At the beginning, it was our main goal to have something fully generic. And then we realized that it might be a mistake to focus only on the technical part to achieve this goal because we take the risk that to spend a lot of resources for a product that can do everything but nothing at the same time. As we saw before, the data model, each data model of investigation are very different. So in Crowd Newsroom now, we really focus on what is common to every crowdsource-based investigation, and the screenshot that I showed you before, for instance, the backend, this how journalists will fact-check the data. This is common, for instance, the fact that it's not necessarily a form, but more a path. This is common, so we focus on these features. And at the end, it's I don't really believe that we can have a 100% generic tool where no help of developer is needed. But if we achieve the goal where for an investigation like this, you need like 10% of time of a developer, instead of redoing everything from scratch at the beginning, it's always a lot of time that we can save. In the future as well, for Chrome Newsroom, we are building at the moment what we call a conversational form. So it's not web-based, we mostly work on phone, and it will be like kind of a chatbot. So the chatbot will guide the user through different paths according to the answer that the user gave. And we think it's very important to bring a bit more of gamification in this kind of topic. And the biggest step and the next level will be for us to be able to use the crowd, not only to ask them and to collect data, but as well to ask help of people and analyzing the data. It's a bit of challenging because then we want to keep, as I said before, privacy and keep the data anonymous. But on the other end, we're thinking of a way where we can use people. For instance, when we had this this request, the Grand Programme, say it again, what's the name?
Land registry
request. Most of the time, we received letters, so via post, with the name of the owner, but handwritten. So it's really like manual work that was made, and to put it in a structured way and easily analyze the data, we need to OCR this. And we're thinking that maybe in the future, if we can use the crowd to help us to do this kind of manual work and help us investigate, or for instance, when we have like people that have the same name, trying to say if it's the same person or two different persons. And it's something, but I'm thinking about the close future. Thinking we are getting close here, close. But I think it can be a very, very interesting step in crowdsourcing.
Yeah, so I think we are kind of through with our presentation. There is a couple of minutes left. So if there's one or two very good, immediate, short questions. So you were the first one, sorry. Yeah.
Hello.
Hi. I
live in Berlin, and I'm very interested in this issue. How far along are you with the project in Berlin? And are there any particular hurdles that you have come across that are quite particular to Berlin in terms of gathering that ownership data?
So yeah, you said rightly, so one of the six cities is Berlin, where we're doing the project, which is very successful. Many, many people participate. Of course, Berlin is a special city, so it attracts also like special people, yeah, in terms of investing into the city. So we get a lot more kind of dirty stuff, which we didn't see in Hamburg. Or if you go to Düsseldorf, a city in the west of Germany, you know, it's not that dirty on the surface. But Berlin is dirty on the surface. So that's why it's a lot of fun actually to work there with these information. But yeah, you're waiting for specific what's specific there, yeah, about these owners. I wouldn't like to go into details too much because we are just about to plan a larger publication with our partner there in the next weeks, the next month. So there we will kind of try to come up with some interesting stuff. But I don't want to tell you too much about the content.
But will it be possible for someone who is an anti-money laundering investigator, such as myself, to actually be able to see some of the raw ownership data when you're finished?
So the question is, you know, like, are other people, you know, be allowed to look into these data? It's a huge issue about privacy and how we deal with these data. There might be some form of companies where we easily can publish, you know, any information about it, that anyone who's interested can also look at it. Of course, we make them available after our after the publication. So I think there's a new, you know, it has been done in other investigations in the last years, like making as much as possible available to the public. So this is also like a part what we try to do, but we have to really sort out, you know, the private owners and the owners where we think, okay, there's something about it. Another question.
How do you make sure that all communities are being heard and that are uploading the information? How do you get, well, everybody, expats, older people, multicultural communities involved?
So our point is not to have everyone, and as I say here, not here, but, the main point about this investigation and crowdsourcing in general, you cannot expect a statistical analysis. You cannot have a fully comprehensive database. It's not the point. First, it's impossible because then it will mean indeed like everyone participates. But we have too many biases. In Hamburg, for instance, it was very obvious in the map that the people that participate was concentrated on a specific district. Mostly young people. It's not the point to have a fully.
But maybe to add to that, so we are actually trying to get. Of course, I mean there are people who are not, you know, used to upload something in the internet. So we have a very small local newspaper who's doing the same thing. And what they did is actually they printed the interview in their newspaper. So it was a page. So you could actually, you know, like. Take your scissors and then send it in via mail. So that's actually something which I think was very, very good and very useful. In terms of reaching all communities, we also thought about, you know, like maybe, you know, like trying to reach communities which are not natively Germany speaking. Yeah, like Germany, you have like some communities which are rarely reading the local newspaper. So we tried to get there through Facebook groups. But the result was kind of mixed, yeah. So I think the kind of minority groups, we did get some responses, but not too many. Yeah. If there's more questions, I would suggest that I would offer that you ask the questions to us directly, because I think we're kind of over the time. And you have to run for the next one. So okay. So I would say thank you very much for listening, and I hope you take something home.